Welcome to this service of worship, where we will give thanks to God for the life of Pam Tiffany Layfield. As Pam faced surgery last Monday for a fourth lung cancer diagnosis, a friend recommended to her the song Still Waters, sung by Christian artist Leanna Crawford. Pam's family is fairly certain that she listened to it that Monday morning on the day of her surgery. They think this because she had a habit of regularly, perhaps even daily, clearing her history, her cash, on her phone. After Pam's passing, they found this song still open in her browser. May it minister to us as it did to Pam.
Said at 103, write scripture on your heart for when you need it. 'Cause anxiety hates Psalm 23, so just say it to yourself till you believe it. And I'm feeling like I'm needing it right now. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leads me by still waters till my fears are gone. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, oh, I know you are with me, my Father, my friend. Your goodness and mercy will follow.
Still waters till my
I invite you to join me in our responsive call to worship. We gather to worship God, the author of the world's joy and the bearer of the world's pain. We give thanks for the abundant grace of the Lord. We remember and we celebrate the life that Pam Tiffany Layfield lived in our midst. We recall with gratitude the blessing of her life touching ours. We give thanks for the gift of God in her to us. We have come in our weakness to share the presence and strength of the Lord. Let us remember that Jesus said, "I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." Let us rejoice in God's presence with us, in death as in life, among those who mourn, as with those who now see God face to face. Blessed be God's glorious name forever. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have loved us with an everlasting love. As we celebrate Pam's life today, hold us in that love as we hold on to our faith and trust in you. You know what it is to lose a part of yourself, for you sent your only Son into the world to live, love, and die for us. Fill our grieving hearts with your understanding and compassion. For all that Pam was to us, and for all that we were to her, we thank you. Though we see Pam no longer, she is with us in spirit and will continue to influence our lives. Lord, you have walked with others through grief and loneliness. Be our companion now and in the days to come. Embrace us in your steadfast love. And give us that deep peace which comes as we live in you and you live in us. With all your people, we look forward to that time when you will swallow up death and wipe the tears from the faces of all people. And now, as your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ taught us to pray, we pray this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I know in the program it says I'm going to do a solo, but while I'm up here, I'm going to go ahead and speak my piece because I don't know if I have the strength to get back up here again. I just want to firstly thank everyone for coming. If it isn't a testimony to how much my mama loved everyone and how much everyone loved my mama, to see all of y'all out here for us. I don't know what else is. Because my mama loved, and she just loved and loved and loved. Every single soul here, my mama loved. And some that aren't here that couldn't be here for illness, for traveling, for distance, whatever that reason may be. My mama loved you all. Every single one. Well, I'm going to be singing Amazing Grace. I requested that there be no music so that way my voice would be the first thing my mama hears. It might take me a minute to get through it, and I will have the words, so don't fault me for that. But I'm going to take my time. I'm going to try and do my best. Amazing grace, how sweet. that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. This grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been here 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Thank you.
Our New Testament lesson this morning comes from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 13. You most often hear this verse read for weddings. It's all about love. But it's not just love for wedded couples. It's God's love. So hear these words of Scripture. If I speak in the tongues of humans and of angels, but do not have love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no records of wrongs. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now, we see only a reflection, as in a mirror. But then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part. Then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, love remains these three. the greatest of these is love. In January of 1966, on the 26th day, during a blizzard, Pam Tiffany, now Layfield, was born. On the 14th day of October in this year, she departed this earthly life for her heavenly home. In between those dates, Pam lived a life of deep love for her family, her friends, her co-workers, and most importantly, for her Lord. The love of Pam's life is her husband, Sandy. They are high school sweethearts whose vows of love stand firm for 40 years. When I asked Sandy how they met, his face broke out in that signature smile. He was at a high school game when, knowing he had his driver's license and Pam and the other girl, a friend that was with her, did not, they asked Sandy to drive them home after the game. Interestingly, Sandy said it was the other girl who was interested in him. But he only had eyes for Pam. It didn't take long for that attraction to be reciprocated. For classmates, remember Pam writing Mrs. Paul Sanford Layfield on just about everything. Christ is the center of Pam and Sandy's love. As that love matured, they welcomed Madison, then Parker, into that circle of love. The circle widened to include Madison's husband, Tyler, and Parker's wife, Ashley. But then that circle burst wide open to include Everett, Madison and Tyler's firstborn son, and the proverbial apple of Pam's eye. Christ remains the firm circle, the firm center of that circle of love. Throughout Pam's career, her work colleagues were blessed with Pam's valued work ethic, her servant heart, and her loving kindness. Janine Rywick, Pam's supervisor at the extension agency at the time, shared this story with me. In 2017, the staff traveled to South Carolina to a spot that was purported to be a great place to see the coming eclipse. The area was filled with people, vehicles, and tents. The crowd resembled tailgating at sporting events. As the evening progressed, the extension agency sat in chairs awaiting the eclipse. Suddenly, a toddler appeared before them. He paused, looked at everyone, then made a beeline for Pam, raising his arms toward her. What do you know she did? She reached down and said, "Come up here, sweet boy." And she settled him on her lap. Janine said it looked like he knew instinctively that Pam was a safe and loving place. And she was. That boy had toddled over from a neighboring group, stationed a couple of tents away. He was reunited with his family, but in the meantime, picture him wrapped in Pam's love. From her colleagues at the extension office, I learned that Pam was a perfectionist, who at times could overthink a project. Whenever that occurred, her workmates would say, with good humor and great love, the hamster's on her wheel again. Pam wanted whatever she did to be the best it could be. Pam's faith in Christ was nurtured and lived out in her service to this church. That servant heart was often found in the kitchen. But she served on many other committees and teams. She and Sandy are faithful worshipers who could be found sitting in their spot on the Lord's Day. This morning, one of her prayer shawls is placed where she normally sits. Last Sunday, October 13th, I was invited to the Layfields table for lunch. We enjoyed dining on Pam's good food and sharing in sweet fellowship. And when we finished the meal, we moved into the den for more conversation. I noticed how calm and peaceful Pam seemed. Was there fear? Of course there was. But that foundational love of Christ was greater than her fear. Pam said she believed when her surgery was delayed a week due to a respiratory virus that God had given her more time to tell people that she loved them and to hear that love voiced back to her. And she did. I've heard multiple stories of people she made a beeline to share her love for them and to hear it reciprocated. To say that last Monday was a hard day is an understatement. This family breathed a sigh of relief when the surgeon reported that the surgery had gone better than expected. Then, in less than an hour's time, we learned that due to a blood clot, Pam's heart stopped beating. They were unable to bring her back. Through the shock and grief of those heartbreaking moments, I observed a family held firmly together by a big, fierce love. The question of why still lingers. We've talked about how death can be a different kind of healing. But in the midst of the questions and grief, that enormous love grounded in faith in Christ still stands. I've seen it every day since Monday. On Thursday morning, I sat once again at the Layfield table, this time to plan this service. As we began, I invited us to pray together. So I bowed my head. But before I spoke, I felt a gentle tap on my hand. It was Sandy, who looked at me and said, "We hold hands." Immediately, I said, "Of course you do. Of course you do." This family holds hands in prayer. This family looks for God's hand in everyday life, and when they see it, they point it out to others. It's a spiritual discipline for this family. They've inspired me to pay closer attention to the daily reminders of God's loving presence in our world. Reverend Harry Workman pastored this church when Madison and Tyler and Parker and Ashley were married. He was invited to preside today, but he was obligated to mission work in the western part of our state. He's helping with disaster relief. I believe Pam would say he's where he's most needed today. Interestingly, when I spoke with Reverend Workman, he shared the same story that Parker shared with me on Thursday. Reverend Workman was teaching a Sunday school class, and the subject was love. Reverend Workman shared that without something to love, love has no meaning. After thinking on that for a moment, Parker summarized that thought this way. Love needs an object. On Thursday, Parker added, grief is love with nowhere to go. Parker, Madison, Sandy, Debbie, everyone here. Right now, the love you have for Pam is tangled up in grief. But as you heal, as you recall with joy the bright light that Pam was, your love for her will settle back into a new place. Pam is still the object, just in a different way. It will show up in the way you practice kindness like Pam did. It will show up in the way you serve like Pam did. It will show up in the way you love, like Pam loved. Scripture teaches that when we Christians are in right relationship with God through Christ, we bear the fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Didn't we see those in Pam in abundance? She was a bearer of those fruit. Not perfect, yet a daily bearer of those fruit. In memory of Pam, may we bear the same. Amen.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's going to heal in time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed are healing mine. The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile tears fall down is the only scars in heaven or on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. But now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. And all your pain's a million miles away. The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. All the old will be made new, and the thought that makes me smile now. The only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you
now. Testament lesson this morning comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 41, verse 10. This verse hung on the wall in Pam's office. And on Thursday, 3 days after Pam's death, Sandy opened his phone to read a daily devotional that he and Pam shared. It was Isaiah 41, 10. Hear the word of the Lord. Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. Amen.
When I decided on what I wanted to share, God simply said, love. I wanted to tell you about Pam's love, but I think it's quite evident with all of you here today. We all have God-given gifts, and Pam's was definitely love and service. And we know that the greatest and strongest thing you will ever know is love. And I have to say, a sister's love is like no other. Pam was 2 when I was born. And I'm pretty sure she told Mom to take me back to the hospital. It was just the 2 of us for almost 16 years until our precious baby sister was born. And she came into our lives and made us 3. I know many of you here might find this hard to believe, but I wasn't the easiest sister. When I was reflecting on all of the memories, it dawned on me that Pam was my very first friend. She has always been in my life, good or bad. She's always there, especially when I need her. Pam's love for her family is stronger than anything I've ever witnessed. She is our rock, and she is our leader, and she is the best big sister I could ever ask for. And a piece of my heart is missing and will not be whole until I'm with her again. You all know how very close our family is, and our girls' outings are not going to be the same. But we know that memories are a gift from God for us to share. And Mom, you have 58 years of those memories all bundled up safe inside of you. And I can't imagine what you're feeling knowing what we feel. Pam was your firstborn, and I know what a special relationship that is. But Mom, I would like to take a minute to express our gratitude to you for your love of Christ. Thank you for taking us to church. Or should I say making us go to church? Even when we didn't want to go. Thank you for being an example of what it means to have a Christian home. Thank you for leading us to the Lord. Because of your love for God, and it has been shared through Pam so many times all of these years. Mom, when you first saw Lauren and I the night Pam went to be with the Lord, you held our faces in your hand and you said, there should be 3. Mom's favorite saying when you tell her you love her is love you more. And I want you to know there's still 3 of us, because she lives on in me and she lives on in Lauren, and we will love you more for her. Lauren, I know you're gonna find this hard to believe, but Pam and I didn't always agree on things. Shocker. But one thing we always agreed on was that you were the best little sister in the whole wide world. God knew what he was doing when he planned you for us. Pam was my first friend, and then she became yours. And I was glad to share her with you. Not other things, but Lauren. I know it must have been hard for you growing up having 3 moms. And now Pam has passed the baton on to me to be your oldest sister here on this earth, and I gladly accept it. I plan to make her proud and love you for the both of us. Aunt Vanessa, Pam loves you more than just a niece loving her aunt. She loves you as one of her very best friends. You have always said that Pam was like a daughter to you, and she knows how very much you love her. We will keep her memory alive and laugh for her during our girls' nights. I get tickled just thinking about her laugh because it is the best. I have to tell you about another sister that Pam has, and that is Tammy Gathens. Tammy, I want to say thank you for loving Pam throughout her life. She loved you so much, and I know you feel as though you lost a sister as well. Tammy shared with me this week that if it wasn't for Pam, she wouldn't know the Lord. Tammy was at our house a lot growing up, and Mom had a rule that if you spent the night on Saturday night, you were going to church on Sunday, no questions asked. So Tammy had a lot of opportunities to go to church with us, and she told me that she was in church with Pam, and she told her that she felt the Holy Spirit telling her that she needed to go down to the altar, and that she was scared. And Pam said, "I'll go with you." And she grabbed her hand and held a hold of Tammy's hand, and she led her to the altar, and she helped to have her accept Jesus Christ as her Savior and Lord. This is the first time I heard this story, but it didn't surprise me at all, because there again, that was Pam sharing her gift of love. And speaking of love, the person here today that has loved Pam with his whole heart and who has the most memories of Pam is her wonderful husband. Sandy has loved Pam the majority of his life and hers. I know how seriously, Sandy, you took your vows till death do us part. But I know he just wanted to be many more years down the road. Pam and Sandy. Just saying their names is like saying peanut butter and jelly. They just go together. Pam loves her Sandy man like no other. It's evident in your everyday life. I'm so glad you were able to renew your vows and express your love all over again. And Sandy, I want you to know how truly grateful I am for your love for Pam all these years. The way you have always cared for her means the world to me. God truly created you to be her husband and to be the father of her children and to be a part of our family. We love you so very much, and I pray that you feel Pam's love through all of us. And then when you didn't think Pam's love could grow any bigger, along came the second love of her life, Madison. I remember seeing Pam right after she became a mom, and I was blown away by just the aura of her love. She was so in love, and she's the best mom ever. Madison, I don't think Pam could ever hug you, kiss you, or tell you enough to express her love for you. She is so very proud of you and of everything you have become. We were looking at old photos the other night, and all of the memories of Pam as a young mom were such happy ones, just like you are now. Madison, you have all of the best of Pam in you as a person and now as a mom. She loves to see you laugh and be happy. Her gift of love in you will live on forever. You were my first niece, and I couldn't love you more than if you were my own. I want you to know that I will be here for you in every possible way and hopefully make Grammy Pammy proud. I am honored to have her trust in me to love you here on this earth until you see her again. And then came along her baby boy. Her family was complete when you were born, Parker. Her love doubled as a mom. Parker, you will always be her baby. And I know you carry her in your heart and your soul. You're the kindest and most thoughtful man. Those qualities you have from your mom will also live on in you. You have blessed so many people with the love you have for your mom. I remember when you were born as well, and I thought Pam was going to have to walk around with a spoon because she just wanted to eat you up with those little cheeks. She is the most wonderful mother that God put on this earth, and she was meant for just two. I have to share one of my fondest memories of Pam. Pam and I were pregnant at the same time with Parker and with Sarah. And when Parker was a month old, I went into labor. And Pam came to the hospital with a one-month-old and a four-year-old. And by the way, in case any of you didn't know, that when one of our crews is in the hospital, we all go to the hospital. They just have to deal with us because we don't take no for an answer. Anyway, Pam left her own children in the lobby with family just to come in and be with me. She knew I was having a hard time, and she stayed with me. and she helped bring Sarah into this world. I will never, ever forget how much that meant to me to have my sister by my side. To be honest, if it hadn't been for Pam and a drill sergeant nurse I had, we always joked I might still be in labor. I don't remember my pain of labor, but I do remember Pam's labor of love for her sister who was in pain. I have saved the best for last, and his name is Everett James Leopard. I just thought Pam had an aura surrounding her with Madison and Parker, but then that sweet grandbaby was born. Man, her love, it just seeps out of every pore in her body. Madison, I want you and Tyler to know that Everett is the last best thing that ever happened to Pam while she was on this earth. Everyone who knows Pam knows what a happy person she is, and she has been soaking up all the good this life has offered her. She is truly one of the happiest people I know. When Madison got married, we were just about to go into the reception, and I saw Pam over to the side crying, and I went over to comfort her, thinking something was wrong. I was like, everything was beautiful, it's okay. And she said, no, you don't understand. But with my diagnosis, I asked God to please let me see my children get married and to meet my grandchildren. And this is the first wish he has granted me. And then Parker got married. I look at Pam's life like a big old chocolate ice cream sundae, and Everett was the cherry on top. I will say to you all that I believe in guardian angels, and I believe that Pam will be a part of our lives on this earth, from up above or here on this earth. Her role as a mother, a wife, a sister, a grandmother, a friend, doesn't stop, is an eternal role. Pam, I want to take this time to say thank you for loving me and being an extraordinary example of what it means to be a mom, a friend, and a sister. I will love you forever, and I will miss you every single day of my life. Save me a good seat. I can't wait to play games with you again. Please let Pam's love be a lesson for you all. Love with your whole heart. I will end this and tell you all that Pam does love us with her whole heart. And if she were physically here today, she would say, Mom, thank you for your unconditional love. Lauren, thank you for being the best sister. Sandy, thank you for loving me and being the best husband and father. Madison, thank you for being the best daughter. Parker, thank you for being the best son. Everett, thank you for being the best grandson. And to everyone that came today, thank you for being a part of my life. I love you all.
Now that I've had some time to reflect on the past few months, I feel confident that God gave Pam a peace and understanding that she wouldn't be on this earth much longer. And Pam, being Pam, not wanting anyone to worry, didn't quite tell us the exact message he might have given her. But instead, she took the time to love on us, each of us, in her own special way. Last Thursday, Pam asked me to have a conversation with her that I will treasure all the rest of my days. We laughed, we cried, we held hands, and we hugged like we've never hugged before. Looking back, there was a certainty and a peace in Pam's eyes that is really hard for me to describe. On this Monday, as I drove to Charlotte to be with our family for Pam's surgery, I was incredibly anxious. I turned on Christian radio to find something to soothe my nerves. No lyrics seemed right until the song Honey in the Rock came on. And immediately the volume went up along with my hands, and my heart was filled with the Lord's presence. Some of the last lyrics of the song, which are repeated several times, is, "Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus." I arrived at the hospital and walked in, not knowing how soon that trust would be put to the test. Shocked, hurt, broken, confused. Just a few words to describe how each of us have felt since Pam's passing. And many times this week, my mind has drifted back to our last conversation. One of the things we talked about was our daddy, and how since he's passed, I've always received little signs, or God winks, of his continued love and presence in my life. Now that Pam has gone to heaven, I've wondered if I would receive the same from her. On Wednesday, I got my answer. I was alone and starting to prepare what I might say today to honor my sister, not knowing where to even begin to convey how wonderful she is. The thought occurred to me that I didn't know what Pam's name meant, and maybe I should look up the meaning behind the name Pamela. After a quick Google search, AI said this. The name Pamela is of Greek origin and is derived from the Greek words pan, meaning all, and meli, meaning honey. The name Pamela is generally considered to mean all sweetness or honey. People with the name Pamela are often described as outgoing, confident, and friendly. I couldn't help but laugh reading this description because of how perfect it was. And then, like the weight of a wave in the ocean, it hit me. The song, the one that had settled my heart on the way to the hospital, Honey in the Rock. Then I really began to laugh and weep all at the same time, and this feeling of warmth just washed over me. My first God wink from Pam, my sweet Pam. Sweet, the very word that I've heard so many of you use over and over this week to describe my sister, along with several other phrases like a warm demeanor and gentle spirit, a beautiful and kind soul, a smile that would light up a room, a joyful and contagious laugh. Others have also said, Pam always made me feel welcomed. I never saw Pam without a big smile on her face and a kind word to say. Pam was so genuine, an angel on earth. And yes, I agree, Pam is all of those things and so much more. One thing about Pam some of you may or may not know is how deep her love of animals really is. Through the years, Pam has cared for many beloved pets. But this one time, she also took in a baby squirrel fresh out of a tree. For a couple of weeks, she tried really hard to keep that squirrel alive, feeding it, warming it, cuddling it, until one day the squirrel became unwell and started going downhill. And Pam, being Pam, did what only she would do. She gave that squirrel CPR. Yes, mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. The squirrel with no hair that looked more like a rat. I wish I could say her valiant efforts brought the squirrel back to life, but that wasn't the case. The point, though, is this. She tried. Like everything else in Pam's life, she gave it her absolute all, whether at home with her family or at work with her colleagues. Pam has been devoted to doing her best. Someone commented this week that Pam never hesitated to help, and you best believe it was going to be right. Pam did do and want things done right. That's how she showed her love and devotion by ensuring that everyone around her was not only taken care of, but taken care of well. Still now, Pam is taking care of me, her baby sister, who she did refer to as Precious, by the way. I believe the song I was fortunate to hear Monday morning and the reference to the meaning of her name now was God-breathed and Pam-inspired to give me strength and hope to help me find the words to say to all of you here today. The phrase honey in the rock found in the Psalms is a metaphor for God's provision even in difficult times. The contrast between the sweetness of honey and the hardness of rock symbolizes how God can provide goodness in unexpected places. This place, this heavy, sorrowful place that we are all in, is most certainly unexpected. How can there be any good in losing a wife, a mother, a daughter, a sister, a niece, a friend? But God wanted me to know, and all of you to know, that through it all, Pam is the good, the honorable life that she lived, and the great love that she shared with us is the goodness. Pam herself is and will always be the honey in this rock. I could really go on and on about my sissy, but I'll close with a final thought for Sandy, Madison, and Parker. The last words Pam messaged me on Monday morning, as you three might expect, were, "I love you a bushel and a peck." This sentiment was something our daddy used to say as a farewell, and it stuck as an expression of love for the Layfield family. Many of you know this saying, too, and that it ends with the words and a hug around the neck. This week, a good friend of mine reminded me that Pam has now gotten that hug around the neck. It's no longer just a saying. For her, it is complete. And one day, one sweet day, each of us will get that hug too. Until then, we will do what Pam has asked of our family, and I pray all of the rest of you here today will commit to do the same, and that is to hold tight to our faith, to love one another, to take care of one another, and to always be friends.
Yeah.
lot. Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul, my sin. The bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, O my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well, it is well with my soul. We
began this service hearing a song that was written inspired by Psalm 23. Let's end this service together by standing and reading it responsively with zeal. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Before I pronounce the benediction, the family has asked me to inform you that they are going to recess out as you are singing How Great Thou Art. And I encourage you to sing that with zeal in celebration of the life of Pam Tiffany Layfield. So hear now this benediction. What we choose changes us. Who we love transforms us. How we create remakes us. Where we live reshapes us. So in all our choosing, may God make us wise. In all our loving, may Christ make us bold. In all our creating, may God's Spirit give us courage. In all our living, may we become whole. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and those you love, and those for whom you pray this day and forevermore.